just before we get started, thank you for all of our guests, and we're going to have an official, but I just want to remind everyone of some Ring Central or Zoom etiquette in this room. We'll ask everyone, if you're not speaking, please, to keep your microphones on mute. We also know that throughout the broadcast that potentially you might not be able to keep your camera on all the time. That's fine, as long as you have up a appropriate image of sorts. If you are off camera, that's perfectly fine. Beyond that, if you find you need to step away, of course you would put your image up, which is okay. Just ask everyone to please mind your mics as we're beginning to speak. This will be recorded, so we'll be able to share that with everyone as well. So that's why it's particularly important to make sure that we keep our microphones off and that we're observing our best etiquette during this time. So we are also we're going to have and ask everyone, if they have questions or things that come to your mind during the presentation, please use the chat to indicate your questions. We're going to have persons actually monitor the chat to be able to share with our presenter later so that she can answer those questions also. Feel free as you go through and you think about things to use the chat. We will be able to answer probably all of your questions tonight. If not, we'll answer some later. So with that, we say thank you so much, everyone, and enjoy the program. And we'll hand it off to our to Mayor Smith to begin to issue the welcome. Thank you.
Hello and good evening, everyone. My name is Tamara Smith, and I have the honor of serving as the co-chair of the program committee for the National Coalition of 100 Black Women Delaware Chapter. The National Coalition of 100 Black Women Incorporated Delaware Chapter's mission is to advocate on behalf of Black women and girls to promote leadership development and gender equity in the areas of health, education, and economic empowerment. As a director from the president of our chapter, Ms. Melanie Daniels, we have looked to partner with organizations whose focus aligns with ours as it aligns to economic empowerment, education, and health. We are happy to say we have a long and wonderful relationship with Ms. Michelle Taylor and United Way, and are excited to bring this programming to each of you tonight together. This Real Talk series continues to shed light on the disparities that Black women face in the times of COVID, and also not in the times of COVID as well. We appreciate you joining us this evening for what is sure to be an informative presentation and also discussion. I'm going to pass it now to my fellow co-chair of program, Monica Shockley Porter.
Just before Monica, can we have a few words from Michelle Taylor? She's on.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. And Tamara, we value this longstanding partnership that we have had with the National Coalition of 100 Black Women. Today, I am wearing the hat, though, for the Delaware Racial Justice Collaborative, which is focused on eradicating systemic racism in Delaware, those policies and practices and institutional customs and culture that hold back a class of people and replace it with those that are more equitable for all. And so we too are focused on a lot of the same things, right? Today we're talking about health equity, which is one of our key focus areas, but we also care about wealth creation and criminal justice reform and education reform and just addressing diversity, equity, and inclusion throughout our state. And we are pleased to partner with you. We know that there are several other partners that are part of this, such as Trinity Health and Wilmington Community Advisory Council and State Community Action. That while we are doing this, or it seems on a Zoom, the great value of this is it is statewide. And so we hope that people are zooming in across our state. And as someone already mentioned, I'm glad we are taping and recording this so that it can be seen and the information can be shared, because we are really focused on what we're calling Race to 100, which is we would like to see all brown and black individuals getting the vaccination. And we have an opportunity to make history by ensuring that there is no disparity in the vaccination from those of in our community that are Caucasian to those that are in the brown and black community. And this is one effort to get us there. So thank you for the partnership.
We are grateful for it and so happy to have you here and so happy to see you as always. And I'll now pass it to Monica to share a little bit more about our health initiatives.
Greetings, everyone. The National Coalition of 100 Black Women Delaware chapter's mission is to advocate on behalf of Black women and girls through our national programming that has to do with health, education, and economic empowerment. Tonight, I'm going to talk a little bit about our initiative as it relates to the impact of COVID with Black women. So we are in challenging times right now, and Black women are facing challenges. We're being impacted physically, financially, and emotionally by COVID-19. So how is NCBW advocating on behalf of Black women? As a group whose mission has always been to advocate on behalf of Black women, we felt that it was critical to develop a messaging and programming campaign for Black women that speaks to our needs during the pandemic. Sisters Saving Sisters Beyond the Mask is our health equity campaign. So with this programming, we have monthly programs to assist Black women with coping, sharing health information, resources, strategies that are all focused on health equity. We are also serving as a resource and encouraging women to research for themselves and for their families as it relates to the vaccine. We are also proudly launching a campaign that is developed by Black women for Black women. I would implore you all to visit the Beyond the Mask website that can be found at www.beyondthemask.info. It is our goal to assist Black women with coping strategies. We also want to share resources as well as communicate the need for equitable rollout of the vaccine. I'm going to now pass this over to Enid Wallace, our sister who will introduce our esteemed speaker for this evening. Enid, take it away.
Okay, good evening, everyone. I'm Enid Wallace Sims, and I am here to, do I need to do anything?
No.
No? Okay.
You're fine.
Okay, I'm here to introduce our sister, Marshala Lee, MD, MPH, board certified family physician, with a demonstrated history of federal and local grants administration, program management, workforce development, and caring for underserved communities. She has skills in coalition building, conducting community-based research, financial management, program evaluation, policy analysis, and mentoring. Committed to fostering a healthier world by decreasing workforce shortages, eliminating health disparities, and providing culturally appropriate care. She is also my sister friend, who is a member of the Board of Directors of Communities and Schools of Delaware, which is a national dropout prevention program. And in her spare time, she is medical director of Shortridge Academy School-Based Health Center. She provides comprehensive health care to students, a volunteer physician for Shepherd's Clinic, and she provides comprehensive health care for patients who cannot afford commercial insurance, yet do not qualify for government assistance. She also is Harrington Value Institute Community Partnership Director at Christiana Healthcare System. She directs the Harrington Value Institute Community Partnership Fund and Harrington Value Institute Translational Research Internship Program, responsible for establishing new, strengthening, and existing community partnerships with a focus on developing study, testing, implementing, and ultimately sharing new models of patient-centered healthcare delivery and methods for addressing the social determinants of health. Welcome, Marshala Lee.
Thank you so much, Sister Enid, for that warm introduction. Sometimes I get tired of hearing about myself, so thank you for cutting it off. I'm very thankful of the opportunity to be here this afternoon. Good evening to all of our viewers. It is indeed an honor to have been asked to serve as a Real Talk presenter. Today, I will be discussing how COVID-19 has affected Black women and girls and will be providing recommendations for us to maintain and hopefully even improve our physical and mental health during the pandemic and beyond. Next slide.
Okay.
I'll first start by discussing how Black families have been affected by COVID-19 and recommendations for us to address COVID-19. I'll then discuss mental health disparities that have been exacerbated by COVID-19 and recommendations for caring for your physical and mental health. And I'll leave you with a few resources that you can check out after our presentation today. COVID-19 disparities. You can leave it here. So since we were first introduced to COVID-19 approximately a year ago, more than 32 million Americans have been infected by COVID-19. And more than 577,000 American lives have been lost to COVID-19. That's a lot. Across the United States, ethnic minority groups such as African Americans and Indigenous Americans have been disproportionately affected by COVID-19 and have had higher rates as well as mortality rates than whites. From this slide, you can see that Indigenous Americans suffered the highest rate of deaths, followed by African Americans and Pacific Islanders. Next slide. Taking a deeper dive into the data, Black women are 3 times more likely to die from COVID-19 than white men. Let that sink in. The previous slides detail stats about the mortality rates, but they do not paint the full picture. In addition to the hundreds of thousands of lives that have been lost, the survivors of COVID-19, which are commonly referred to as long haulers, continue to face numerous challenges in their recovery journey. There have been a number of complications that have been known to last several months after the initial infection. Some of those include cardiovascular, heart inflammation, respiratory, lung function abnormalities, acute kidney injury requiring dialysis, rash, hair loss, and other dermatological conditions, and neurological. Many people who lost their smell and taste still have not recovered their smell and taste since being initially affected. The bottom point is one that we'll be focusing on this afternoon. But even when people have not been infected by COVID-19, we know that they have indirectly experienced depression, anxiety, and changes in mood. So COVID-19 can cause this directly as well as indirectly. Next slide. There are a number of factors that have been attributed to the COVID-19 disparities in our communities. A major explanation for the higher incidence rates among communities of color are socioeconomic disparities leading to increased exposure to COVID-19. The different types of employment, being majority frontline workers, having the ability to social distance, decreased health literacy levels, and ability to obtain effective personal protective equipment were barriers that many communities had to overcome. These disparities are largely a result of systemic racism. Another factor that has resulted in higher mortality rates are the high number of pre-existing chronic disease disparities that existed in our communities prior to COVID-19. Hypertension and diabetes are 2 major chronic medical conditions that have been shown to increase the likelihood of poor COVID-19 outcomes. And the rates of these conditions continue to climb during COVID-19 with increasing obesity rates. In addition to the 2 previous factors that I mentioned, increased exposure and increased chronic disease disparities, There are barriers that exist within the health and public health arenas that have also contributed to the COVID-19 disparities. These factors are unequal access to testing as well as vaccinations, affordability and health insurance gaps, provider bias and racism. Yes, provider bias and racism still exists, and we're working hard to overcome them. There is a lack of trust and stigma, which is rooted in not only historical injustices, but also current and present day injustices. We also know that there's a great amount of miscommunication. All of these factors combined lead to higher COVID-19 incidents and mortality among minorities. Next slide. We now have three vaccines that have received emergency use authorization by the FDA. Despite their approval, African Americans have been vaccinated at a much lower rate than whites across the United States. From this slide, you can see that approximately 22% of African Americans have been vaccinated in comparison to approximately 38% of whites. We have a lot of work to do to ensure that our communities are protected from COVID-19. Next slide. The disparity in COVID-19 vaccination rates is due to a number of factors, including decreased availability and access to the vaccine in our communities, mistrust based upon historical and current mistreatment, as I mentioned, misinformation. There's a ton of misinformation on social media. It seems like anyone who has a social media page is a vaccination expert. So you have to be diligent in ensuring that what you are ingesting is good information. And now with what has happened with Johnson & Johnson, many people have very warranted and real safety concerns about the vaccine. We are working tirelessly in the medical community to overcome all of these barriers. And we want you to know that we are also serving as your eyes and ears to make sure that the vaccines are safe. We know that they are effective. We're continuously monitoring the data to ensure that they are safe. The CDC has the V-Safe monitoring app where we're encouraging anyone who gets vaccinated to report any symptoms that they're having, because I promise you that I was concerned initially about the vaccine. I was concerned about how quickly it was developed. But once I saw the data, I was reassured that it was safe and effective. And I also wanted to be one of the first ones who got the vaccine, because I said before, I encouraged anyone else to get the vaccine, that I would wanted to put my life on the line to ensure that it was safe and effective. And I am a true proponent of the vaccine. I trust the science, and I know that it was not developed overnight. And I have consistently been monitoring the safety concerns that have appeared, because trust and belief, if I'm encouraging you to get the vaccine, this is real talk. I'm going to be transparent and share with you the good and bad about the vaccine as well. So you have my trust. Next slide. This slide contains details about the common short-term side effects of the COVID-19 vaccine. And we know that the COVID-19 vaccine are mostly safe and effective. There have been very few side effects that have resulted from the COVID-19 vaccine. Millions of people in the United States have received COVID-19 vaccine under the most intense safety monitoring in the United States history. The side effects listed on this slide, such as pain at the site of injection, headache, fever, fatigue, chills, muscle and joint pain, as well as typically last 1 to 2 days and typically resolve. Severe side effects have been rare and temporary, but we're not discounting any of those side effects. So that's why it's so important that anyone who gets vaccinated, that they sign up for V-Safe, so that if there are more side effects happening, we're able to monitor them and able to do something about them. While data about the safety of vaccines for pregnant women is limited, right there, there's no evidence that the vaccine is linked to infertility or miscarriage. There is no increase in miscarriage rates among people, pregnant women with COVID and women who have received the vaccine. Next slide. It's real talk. And so I know the thing that's on everybody's mind is, Dr. Lee, you said vaccines are safe and effective. What's going on with the J&J? So I wanted to provide you with some updates. So since April 23rd, the CDC and FDA have begun back recommending the use of Johnson & Johnson vaccine. They did a full in-depth analysis of the side effects that had happened to get a better understand of what the cause was and recommendations for going forward. Reports of the adverse events following the J&J vaccine suggest that there is an increased risk of rare adverse event called thrombosis with thrombocytopenia syndrome. Nearly all adverse reports of this serious condition, which can cause blood clots with low platelets, have been in young women less than the age of 50 years old. So the recommendation is women younger than 50 should consider other vaccine options that are available. And thankfully we have Pfizer and Moderna that have been shown to not have these side effects. So Marshala, real talk, what's the recommendation? My sisters, if you are younger than 50, please get the Pfizer or Moderna. I know many people only want the one shot from J&J. That's cool. But we know that there is a small risk for this side effect. And so why open yourself up for a potential side effect if you have other options? I understand getting a second vaccine can be inconvenience, but I want to protect you from any potential side effects. If you decide to get the J&J vaccine, it's important that you monitor yourself for side effects. And if you have any symptoms that may appear to be blood clots, such as shortness of breath or pain in your legs, you need to seek immediate care. And also make sure that it is reported in VSafe so that we have an accurate representation of how many side effects and how many clots and incidents are happening. Next slide. Getting vaccinated is a personal decision. My job is to provide you with accurate information, but ultimately it's your right to make the decision. We know that the vaccine not only decreases your risk of potentially being hospitalized, but we know that it also decreases your risk of spreading COVID-19 to your loved ones. Again, getting the vaccine is your personal decision. But my request is, if you decide to not get vaccinated, and even if you do get vaccinated, it's important that you still follow the COVID-19 safe practices. Wearing a mask. Wearing a mask, you guys. There are a lot of different types of masks out there. And I understand that some people say that they're uncomfortable. I can think of at least 10 different types of masks. Please try them out and figure out which one works best for you. We know that masks are the biggest tool that we have in our arsenal to decrease the spread in addition to the vaccine. We ask that you call your doctor before going in if you're having symptoms, because we know that there are a lot of immunocompromised individuals who are at the doctor's office. So if there's a chance that you have COVID-19, why put your colleagues, your neighbor at risk of COVID-19? There are many ways that you can get tested and not jeopardize the health of your neighbors. We know that it's important to wash your hands, clean surfaces, don't touch your face, continue to socially distance, and stay home if you feel like you have flu-like symptoms, and seek emergency care and consultation with your doctor. We know that these steps are as less important than wearing your mask, but one thing that we know right now is flu rates are much lower with since we've been putting these safety standards into practice. So I recommend continue to do all these things as best as possible. And I'm one of those type of people, I probably will wear a mask at least a year after they tell us that we don't have to anymore, because I want to keep myself and my family safe. Next slide. We know that a number of mental health disparities have existed pre and post COVID. Black women are facing an overwhelming mental health crisis. Next slide. May is Mental Health Awareness Month, and it is the perfect time for us to shine a light on this crisis. We must stand up against stigma and all the other barriers that prevent us from seeking care. Next slide. Recently, our forever First Lady, Michelle Obama, spoke about experiencing low-grade depression. She said it was caused by the double pandemic of COVID-19 and racial strife. It was a striking admission from a woman regarded as a strong role model. But as a Black female medical provider, we know that even the healer needs healing sometimes. We and our colleagues are well-versed in diagnosing depression and anxiety. Some of us suffer from it ourselves. But what all Black women are facing today is something very different, something additional. Black women sit squarely at the confluence of multiple systems of oppression and are experiencing a disproportionate rate of loss and livelihood in the era of COVID-19. Next slide. The image of the strong Black woman, resilient, driven to succeed, devoted to those around her, is rooted in generations of history. Many women see it as a proud legacy that helps shield them from the insults of entrenched discrimination. But health-wise, that shield might be a double-edged sword. The exceeding demands and emotional strain from COVID-19, compounded by gun violence and racial injustices repeatedly replayed in our brains on our TV screens, has exceeded the resilience level for even the strongest among us. Next slide. Despite the saying that Black doesn't crack, our mental health and physical health suffer from us wearing the cape. This is largely why cardiovascular disease and strokes are so high. We must develop healthy mechanisms for fighting injustices that do not consume us up in the process. Healthy mechanisms are essential for us to run the long race and be more effective for our communities. This slide is the picture of Fannie Lou Hamer, who is one of my sheroes. For the sake of survival of our community, she had to wear the Superwoman cape. She was born less than 50 miles away from my hometown in the Mississippi Delta. She was a health and social justice activist who championed the phrase that we are sick and tired of being sick and tired. Unfortunately, she received a hysterectomy, which was coined at that time a Mississippi appendectomy, without her knowledge, when she went in for a uterine tumor. Ever since then, she continued to fight against health injustices, but unfortunately, she died at the age of 59 from breast cancer. For us to be effective advocates for our community and run the long race, as I mentioned, we have to take care of ourselves. Mm-hmm. Next slide. There's no mask for mental health. There are many signs and symptoms that we often ignore. There are many signs and symptoms that we see in our friends and sisters that we often ignore, but we have to support each other and help each other recognize those symptoms. Next slide. This slide contains a few signs and symptoms that can be mental health warning signs. Feeling anxious or worried is normal, but anxiety could be a sign of a mental health disorder if the worry is constant and interferes all the time. Other symptoms of anxiety may include heart palpitations, shortness of breath, headaches, sweating, trembling, feeling dizzy, diarrhea, and weight racing mind. Feeling depressed or unhappy, again, can be normal. There's a lot of loss going on in our lives. but lack of motivation and energy, interest in a hobby or being cheery all the time that's exceeding a certain time period is abnormal. Emotional outbursts. Everyone has different moods, including Marshala, but sudden and dramatic changes in moods, such as extreme distress or anger, can be a symptom of mental illness. Sleep problems. I know early in the pandemic, it was hard for me to sleep throughout the night. Lasting changes to a person's sleep pattern could be a sign of a mental health disorder. Weight or appetite changes. It upsets me when every time I hear somebody say, oh girl, you lost so much weight, you looking good. But we don't realize that sometimes people lose weight for unhealthy eating behaviors because they're depressed or anxious. And so it's important that we pay attention to our eating habits and make sure that we're practicing healthy eating habits. Being quieter, withdrawn can be a sign of depression, especially when there's significant changes from their normal networks. Substance abuse. We know that there are increased rates of alcoholism with COVID-19. A lot of people want to get away, and unfortunately, these substances are not healthy coping mechanisms. So pay attention to that if you're using substances more than you previously were, and especially unhealthy substances. Feeling guilty or worthless can be a sign of depression. Changes in behavior or feelings. These are all signs of depression that you should be on the lookout for your friends and loved ones. Next slide. So it's important to know when you should call 911 for help. And we know that if anyone discusses that they are suicidal, don't pass go, call 911. That's not the time at that moment in time to call a friend or family or loved one, because you never want to say, what if I didn't? And I know with the current climate that we're facing with police, it's important that when you call 911, that you say and communicate, my family or loved one, I'm concerned about their mental health, but I need you to ensure that you're going to help me care for them and not escalate the situation. And thankfully, many of our police departments, they're going through that training, because mental health emergencies, we rely upon them for keeping our family and loved ones safe. Next slide. Some people are uncomfortable calling 911, and another option that people resort to are these mental health crisis lines. The National Suicide Prevention, the crisis text line by NAMI are two well-known hotlines that people use when there's crisis. So please keep these numbers handy. Next slide. Oftentimes they come to me and say, hey, how do I even find a therapist? And it can be tough. It can be very tough trying to not only find a therapist that accepts your health insurance or will take cash pay, but finding a culturally aware provider is even tough, more challenging. So I go to these resources, and my favorite resource is actually the second link here, which is the Psychology Today link. And when you go there, you can actually find a list of Black therapists in every state. And not only is it a list of the therapists, but they have a bio which explains the areas that they have trained in, their concentration areas, as well as which insurances do they take, and if they don't take insurance, what the copay and cash rates are for therapy. But this is another list, a good list of therapy resources, as well as mental health support resources. Next slide. And unfortunately, therapists, Black therapists and psychologists account for less than 5% of the therapists in the United States. So it's going to be hard to try to find a Black therapist. So it's important that you, even if you don't find a Black therapist, that whoever you go to see is culturally aware. And these are a few questions that you hopefully can ask your therapist at that first visit. because it's important that you have a trusting relationship, not only with your therapist, but also with your physician. So these are questions that you should be able to ask your doctor and your therapist. Have you treated other Black people or received training in cultural competence? If not, how do you plan to provide me with culturally sensitive, patient-centered care? How do you see our cultural backgrounds influencing our communication and my treatment? Do you use a different approach in your treatment when working with patients from different cultural backgrounds? And what is your current understanding of differences in health outcomes for Black patients? Once you go to one therapist, if it's not a good fit, find someone else, because this needs to be a lifelong relationship, someone that you can go to that you feel comfortable and confiding. So these questions are very important. Next slide. After your visit, these are some questions that you can ask. Did my provider communicate effectively with me? Is my provider willing to integrate my beliefs, practices, identity, and cultural background into my treatment plan? Did I feel like I was treated with respect and dignity? Do I feel like my provider understands and relates well with me? If any of these answers are no, it may be time to find a different therapist, and that's okay. Next slide. I want to leave you with a few wellness tips, because some of what we're going through is burnout, and it's important that you have the tips for dealing with all the, not just the end spectrums of mental health, but also this in between. Next slide. This is my top list of wellness tips. Be kind to yourself. Mm-hmm. I know at the beginning of the pandemic, I was working on overdrive because I'm like, it's so much that I need to do to take care of my people. And then I realized I was going to burn out. And Marshala, you're dealing with the same thing that your community is dealing with. So I had to learn to be kind to myself. Eat healthy. We know at first we were locked in our homes, so it was hard to get healthy food. We were like, whatever comes in a can and that I have in my cabinet, that's what I'm eating today. But now that the food supply is picked up, it's important that you be as thoughtful as you can about eating healthy. It's a great time to garden. I know a lot of my friends have picked up gardening. Exercise. Exercise is the great stress reliever, but I know it takes a lot of energy to take that first step. But I promise you, once you regularly start exercising, you have so much more energy, and it's a good stress relief. Stay connected. COVID-19 has caused us to be isolated, but many of us are Zoom and Facebook pros now. And so whatever way you have to stay connected, please stay connected with your loved ones. And now that we're vaccinated, try to see your loved ones, the ones who are vaccinated, in a safe manner. Nourish your spirit. If there's prayer, if there's listening to music, whatever it is, make sure to take time for you. Rest, rest. Rest is the good thing. Rest is not something that you do at the end of the race, but it's something that you do before the race to prepare for the race. Say no. I'm still teaching myself how to say no. It's okay to say no. When you say no, the first time you say no, it's a relief, because then that person that you said no to is going to find someone else to do it. And you're like, oh, it's that easy. So practice saying no and taking time for you. Ask for help. I think the ask for help is even harder than the saying no sometimes. As we wear our superwoman cape, it's okay to put it down sometime and ask our sister, ask our brother to help us out. Help us carry the load. Seek therapy and check your engine light. I didn't mention this, but a lot of those signs, the anxiety, can also be signs that there's something else going on in your physical body. So it's important to see your doctor for preventative care, as well as if you're having any of those signs and symptoms, to ensure that there's not a physical ailment that's causing that, such as thyroid. So these are my wellness tips. Please take them, implement some of them, most of them, all of them, please. Next slide. I want to leave you with a few additional resources. Next slide. The COVID-19 is readily available now. Please go to the state's website and click on this link, where can I find my vaccine? Pharmacies, churches, community centers, there are vaccine distribution events in your backyard. Next slide. find a doc. I mentioned how you can find a therapist. I also serve as the vice president for the Delaware chapter of the National Medical Association, which is the Black Doctors Medical Association that's focused on fighting for health equity. We are revising our website, and on our website, we will be including a directory of NMA doctors in Delaware. So coming soon, be on the lookout. Next slide. And I'm sorry that this list didn't show up, but we know that we've been closed in a long time with our loved ones, and some relationships have grown, and some relationships are on the rocks. And unfortunately, some people have been confined at home with some not so nice partners. And so if you feel that your safety is at risk, or a friend or loved one's safety is at risk, please share these resources, these domestic violence resources with them. Next slide. And this is my contact information. Please feel free to contact me. I hope that I share some information and resources with you today that will assist you with overcoming the mental strain of COVID and helping to live a healthier life. But I'm so excited to be on the other side one day soon of COVID-19, but we have to continue to encourage our loved ones to get vaccinated so that we can go back to living an even better life than we had prior to COVID-19. So feel free to contact me if you have any questions. Thank you.
Thank you. I think we're going to have questions now, and I'm hoping that we've got some in the chat there for Dr. Lee and that wonderful presentation. Do we have any questions in the chat?
We do not have any questions in the chat, none that have popped up that I have seen, but I welcome all participants. If folks would also prefer to come off mute and share any questions they may have, or put them in the chat, either one.
I had a question I wanted to ask Dr. Lee. Thank you so much for that presentation. It was wonderful information, wonderful information. When you were talking about, and I saw there was a resource link for Black girls, because of course, you know, the coalition also advocates for Black women and Black girls. You don't get to be a Black woman without being a Black girl, right? But can you talk a bit more about trends that you're seeing with younger girls or younger women, or talk about perhaps maybe at what age now is it that okay for young girls to begin to get COVID vaccinated, or just some of the things that you're hearing about younger populations and their concerns about COVID?
Yes, we know that our young ladies are also suffering from many of the same mental health strains that the more senior ladies on in the spectrum, such as myself now, are suffering. And so oftentimes they don't display the same signs or symptoms. They can become more reserved and isolated. And we also know that just with being away from their friends, many of our young ladies are missing out on proms, they're missing out on graduations. And so we oftentimes don't think that those are trivial, but those are life events that we really cherish. And so the mental health rates are also increasing among them. We know that the obesity rates are increasing among our youth because many of them are coping with unhealthy eating behaviors. And so I'm thankful that now the vaccine is available for youth 16 and above. So the Pfizer vaccine is available. And so we're hoping that more of our young ladies get vaccinated so we can go back to living an even better life prior to COVID-19. But definitely we have to address some of what they're facing and understanding that they're going through many of the same things and challenges that we're facing, if not more. We've seen a better day. We've lived and seen that this is just a one point in time that we're going to overcome. But for many of them, this has been a long point of time. When you're 16 years old, going through COVID for a year and a half is a long time. And so we have to implement those healthy behaviors so that they see us implementing them and also pick them up as well. And so I know adults are stressed out. Sometimes we act out on our young ladies and aren't as nice to our children as well. And so they feel what we feel. and we need to be there and support them. And so, yes, that link is also a resource for how to talk to your young lady about what they're feeling and their emotions, but also how to help them seek care as well.
Thank you. Thank you so much. But no, okay, there's one.
There's one question in the chat. After being fully vaccinated, do we still need to be tested for COVID-19?
Okay, great question. So we know that some people think that once they go for that second vaccine, that they can go outside and party. We know that it takes at least a week and a half, 2 weeks for immunity to build after the second vaccine. So most of the people who have contracted COVID-19 after being vaccinated, it's been either after the first shot or a few days after they received their second shot. And so if you develop symptoms prior to 2 weeks after receiving the second shot, I would get tested. And so we know that once you're fully vaccinated and you have developed immunity, the likelihood of you actually contracting COVID-19 is very rare. But if you're inside that window period of developing full immunity and you develop those symptoms, it's important that you still get tested.
I have another quick question, Dr. Lee, and I'll share personally a little bit. I was told that one of the things that women have to look out for after getting vaccinated is to be careful about getting their mammograms, in that the mammograms may come back a bit abnormal because of the lymph nodes. Can you talk a bit medically about what happens there and any other tests that perhaps maybe we should pay attention to?
Yes, great question. We know that the vaccine causes an inflammatory and immune response in your body. It's actually a good sign that your immune cells are responding to the vaccine, because that's actually how it keeps you healthy and keep you safe from COVID-19. But that immune inflammatory response occurs throughout your body. So we know that some people have low-grade fever. They know that some people are tired for a few days. But your immune cells live in your lymph nodes. And there are a large number of lymph nodes in your arm and in the areas near your breast tissue. And so that inflammation can be seen during your mammogram. And it can cause concern, and it can warrant biopsy if there's inflammation, because there can be a concern that is breast cancer. So that's why we are recommending that you get your mammogram prior to your vaccine, or waiting 6 weeks after your vaccine to get the mammogram, so that the inflammation is not present on your mammogram and we're not subjecting women to those unnecessary biopsies.
Thank you. What about shingles or any other vaccinations?
We have not seen the need to delay. The recommendation, I believe, is a month, and I don't want to give you misrec information, but there is a period of time that if you're getting a live vaccine that they want you to wait prior to getting a COVID vaccine. So I would recommend you speak to your doctor for your individualized, personalized recommendations. But I believe there is a period of time if you receive a live vaccine before you get the COVID-19 vaccine.
Mm-hmm. So the next question that I see in the chat is a question from one of our members, and it says, how do you feel about traveling now? So I guess this is a question for you, Dr. Lee.
That's a good question. I haven't seen my mom. My mom lives in Memphis. I haven't seen her since Christmas of last year. And I was set to go and visit her in a few weeks. She's fully vaccinated, but there's a concern about the strains that are developing. I'm not sure if you've seen what's going on in India. And so with COVID, we've talked more than we typically have, and even prior to COVID-19. And I'm saying that my goal is, when I see my mom, I want to be able to see her for a long time after I see her. So many people have gone to visit their families, and unfortunately, giving their family members COVID-19. I'm thankful that all of my father and my mom, I was able to convince them to get vaccinated. So I with the current vaccine, it's safe, effective, and I don't think that I can spread it to them. But there are so many unknowns with these variants. And so even when I see my mom, and hopefully I will be able to see her this summer, I plan to wear my mask around her if I'm up and up and close with her. But I'm like, whatever a little inconvenience I have to do to ensure that I'm not spreading it to my loved one, I'm willing to do that. So I recommend that everyone just be as safe as possible. And I know mental health and wellness is so important. And so traveling, a lot of people traveled all the time. And so it's a part of that normalcy. So I'm not discouraging anyone to travel, but I'm saying that if you're going to travel, I recommend definitely getting vaccinated, continue to wear your mask, and keep an eye on the increasing rates and the strains that are in those regions and areas.
There's another question. What do you think about not wearing face masks outside per the CDC recommendations?
So the face mask, I'm actually, I love face masks now. Other than the fact I don't have to put on lipstick, I have typically pretty bad allergies during the summertime. And I've noticed that in the spring, I've noticed that wearing the face mask, my symptoms aren't as bad as they typically are. Uh-huh. So I know that I'm not required to wear it, but I'm like, it's not harming me. And if anything, if it's stopping me from getting other germs, COVID-19 has shown us how nasty some people are. So wearing a mask is a little inconvenience. And that's why I say, just find a mask that's comfortable. When I go in my backyard, I'm not wearing a mask typically. If you're going somewhere and you know that you're able to safely distance, it's not necessary, but I'm now, my mask is a part of me and it will be a part of me for a while.
Our next question is there any more information about having to have a booster shot in the near future? I know that's a big one.
It's a big question. I'm so glad that the shot didn't hurt much, but I believe the Pfizer developers and the Moderna developers think that we probably will have to have a booster. And this is typical of a lot of vaccines, as you know, the yearly flu vaccine. And we're still waiting for more information to see exactly how long the immunity lasts. As you know, the people that were in the clinical trials prior to us, they're still following them. There's no indication that they've lost immunity yet, but they're continuously monitoring them to determine how long their immunity lasts and to see if they need a booster, because if the effectiveness wanes compared to some of the variant strains that are developing across the United States. So the verdict is still out, but I think that there is a good chance that we will need a booster.
I think you're muted, Cherise.
Sorry, here we go. That's our last one. And I have the responsibility of talking about what's next. First and foremost, we just want to say thank you to Dr. Lee. You have given us a lot to think about. We are so grateful for this sister chat, real talk, telling us what we need to know. And I'm sure others are going to lament about that as well. But I am very grateful for you. Grateful for you. Thank you for your service and what you're doing in community. And thank you for saying yes to us to have this chat tonight. Going ahead, I think you heard us earlier. I'm Cherise Brewington Carr. I am the first vice president of programs for the National Coalition of 100 Black Women Delaware chapter. And I'm pleased that all of you joined us this evening. Going ahead, we will continue to advocate on behalf of Black women and Black girls in the areas of education, health, and economic empowerment. Tonight, we're focusing on our health, one of our most important assets and resources that we have for ourselves. And you heard Monica and Tamara talk about our initiatives and specifically looking at our health equity areas beyond the mask. And as Dr. Lee said, you know, 100%, and Michelle Taylor said, we want to get, you know, down to the fact we want to get to the 100 mark to make sure that we are having every individual that can be vaccinated, that wants to be vaccinated, to be vaccinated, particularly in our community. So please stay tuned We will, after this, be able to share with you all the wonderful tips and resources that Dr. Lee provided for us. We're going to upload this recorded meeting tonight on our website so that you will be able to have access to it, as well as to share with those persons who maybe were not able to be with us this evening. And stay tuned, because there's more to come. I'm with Dr. Lee. We're going to be in this for some time to come, and we want to be safe and healthy and be here together. So thank you again so much, everyone, for joining us. And I'm now going to turn this over to Tamara. And I think we also have our Madam President, Melanie Daniels, has also been able to join us as well.
Thank you, Charisse. Melanie did have to sign off, so I'll just be closing us out. So I just want to thank again to Dr. Lee for such an informative presentation. Thank you for your time. Thank you for your expertise. Thank you for providing us with some much needed and much helpful information. Also, again, want to thank Michelle Taylor for your support and partnership. Always grateful to work with you in this space with the Coalition and other places as well. For all of our participants who were here tonight and those who are watching the recording, please feel free to visit our website at ncbwde.org. That's ncbwde.org for more information on our programs and events. I know Dr. Lee provided during her presentation some resources for mental health. We also have some on our webpage, and they're found in two places, one under the Sister Saving Sisters a hyperlink that's at the top of the banner of our webpage for COVID-related resources, as well as also additional just mental health resources that can be found in our webpage as well. So again, that's ncbwde.org. Thank you to everyone for attending. Thank you for your time. Thank you for your support, and have a wonderful evening.
Night, everyone. Thank you. Bye.